So, I guess we can start. Is it 3 o'clock? 4 o'clock, do not want to be too early. Yeah. So, okay, then we start. This session will be taped, and this is in order to make it available to everybody in the internet who wants it for free. We have a, my institute has a culture of offering everything free. So if you are interested, go on our website and you have videos, audios, books, papers, and you can use and exercise everything, make your own use of it. This means, I suppose, that you accept that we do the taping. And my contract should be with you that if you speak out loud and be somehow on the tape, you know that and you agree that this will be on the tape also later. So my name is Bernd Schmid. I am the head of Training Institute for Professionals in the Organizational Field, close here to Heidelberg in Wiesloch. And this is my colleague Anandan, Geethan from Chennai, India, and we are working together since years, and we wrote also a book together and are preparing to do another one to spread the ideas into the English field. Each of us will do a presentation of about 30 minutes, and then we will have 30 minutes for discussions. So if you have any questions, comments, write them down, and then we can talk about that later. I will present you more some general considerations on learning of individuals and systems, and Geethan will give you a more practical, pragmatic version, how he has made models from that and how he's worked in companies in India, and gives you the concrete exercises how we do that, how he does it there. So, I guess you know the situation. You have been to a seminar and you go back to your workplace or your family, to your home system, and you are enthusiastic. And you learn to experience things new and behave new. And people gave you answers to the new way to do things. And then you come home and you meet your spouse. It doesn't work. Or you go to your workplace and you try to show your enthusiasm to your colleagues. And it's very difficult to make them understand what you learned. And it's even more difficult to practice this with them together because they have still the old patterns of behaviors. And you are new to your new patterns of behaviors. And if they would be answered in a good way for you, then you could keep them, the new culture you learned. But if the others play the old music, after some time you will switch back to the old music. And certainly everybody knows this, and still we are spending billions on this kind of education. And at our institute, we experiment a lot with different ways, and I will present you some general ideas, how we think about it and why we try to do that. So those of you who have not yet been in Wiesloch, this is our institute. Two of the seven buildings. And this is our slogan. We are, culture comes from culture. You never will teach somebody new culture unless you involve this person into cultural behavior, give them an experience and make them feel that's how it is about, and you only can do that by examples. And certainly all the cultural works that is stating any values and saying from now on we all want to behave differently and have different attitudes do not have much chance to be realized. So when we started 40 years ago, around 30 years ago, we already worked with the term culture. By then it was very unusual. They said, what do you think about theater or concerts? What has this to do with companies? And I always said, no, I mean the culture not of the feuilleton, I mean the culture of the economic part of the newspapers. Today, culture is a fashion word, and companies spend millions in hiring people to help them to develop a new culture. So it's very lucrative to deal with culture as a term. So, but what is culture? The culture is an umbrella term, how we say it means a lot. My definition is it's the way how reality is shaped consciously and unconsciously, and it's done habitually, and it's also done creatively. So, the way you celebrate Christmas at home, you grew into that, and it's just normal to celebrate Christmas that way, but you certainly could do it differently, and you even are not aware what are the elements of your Christmas celebrating culture. Partly, you want to change something, for example, sing a new song, then you find out that grandma doesn't like it, and she sings the old song, and then you have some confusion. So I always say culture, that's the personality of a system. It's as multi-level defined as personality and has all the definition problems we have also with personality. But we need culture. If you want to change a system, it cannot be changed by writing down everything you how you want to have the new reality. No chance to describe all the dimensions that have to come together to function as a company. There's no chance to change an organization without changing culture. So culture is complex and powerful because culture is supported by a complex interplay of many players in a company. This is why when you come with something new, it will not immediately be answered by others. Say, sing the old song, and after a short time, you give up and sing the old song with them, and it feels like this is the way it must be more natural. How to convince managers of investing into culture? And I use usually this drawing. I'm saying if you immediately start with working task-oriented and result-oriented, it seems to be a short way to come to results. But on the way, you find out that you are not together with cultures. Different departments, different professions coming together, different role understanding. And the more you get into trouble, really being in a shared reality. And after a certain amount of time, very little task-oriented work is done, and you have a lot of cultural problem, have to spend your energy for that anyway. This is why you should start with building up a culture together. And after the same period of time, if you are lucky and doing well, then the investment into culture is going down, and your capacity really to work task-oriented will increase. So it's just, it's not because of humanistic values, it's because of reason, good reasons, also economic reasons, really to invest into culture. So why is it so difficult to reach sustainable positive change in systems? Because, is my answer, not all answers, but one of my answers is because we are unaware or misjudge the stabilizing factors. And what we underestimate the most are the habits of people, Gewohnheiten. And as a psychologist, I learned to deal with motivation of people. When they learn to be differently motivated and have different values, then they will know how to create new behavior and new culture. I do not believe that anymore. It's not the most important factor. The most important factor is to detect habits and interplay of habits that stabilize the old system. Be aware of this, and then combining a lot of interventions to change habits and stabilize these changes together in the system. So, I said it already, overestimated the most is knowledge on a content level. Each of you has the experience that if you know better, you're in a system where you don't. Even if you have the power, it doesn't help you. So, perspectives on what is important when you want to change a culture, as a culture of a system. One is you be prepared to introduce new elements on many levels. On the content level, I will show you later, have different thinking, different models, for example, for communication. Have different settings, how you sit together and who is invited, or have different procedures, how so you try to learn together, and think about your attitude. So on many different levels, because culture is so complex, you have at the same time and in a coordinated way, fitting to each other, try to change culture. And everybody knows if you talk about equal eye-level culture and discussing things and do like I do now, stand up here and teach, this is a discrepancy. Yeah, and usually people learn what they experience and they do not learn what they are told. This is a problem here because the method we can use in that short amount of time is teaching. At our institute, it's only a small part of helping people to learn about developing cultures and systems. So, another point is it's better that souls learn together who share work and share responsibility. Even in our seminars, we have people from many different countries, companies, and they come together and they learn together. And each of them has a problem going back and then introducing the new elements into the culture of their home system. It would be much better, and we have projects to do so, and Geethan will explain how he's working that way in India, to work with these people who already work together every day and share responsibility together. This is more difficult because they also have their habits and their culture. So it's easier to bring new culture to people who are not a well-trained system. But the transfer problem, on the other hand, is so big that it's better to create situations where people who will work together on Monday have them together in a seminar on Friday. And the exercise after seminar learning in the home system is very important. So a big part of our learning process at the Institute is preparing people to direct exercises together with their colleagues and within the leadership chains to transfer the new things they learned. This is why our participants do not only learn to act better as professionals, at the same time they learn to direct learning processes. Because today, working is at a big amount at the same time learning. And working culture means learning culture. But people do not want to make very big jumps into something very new, esoteric, mind-blowing. On Monday, they want something that helps them to do the work they do anyway better. So an important task for us is to chunk down our big ideas into exercises, into procedures that can be done in the home system and can be matched and interlocked with the traditional systems there. And many of our big ideas we could have just dissolved when we say we want to offer something they can use at Monday. So if new elements are not practiced under real conditions afterwards, the chance that new cultural elements will sustain is very little. And we chronically underestimate. If you want to lose weight, many have already tried that. You know it's not a question of being motivated. It's a question of exercising your habits day by day. And if you have done it for 30 days, 40 days, 50 days, then it becomes natural. And then you don't have to think so much about, and then change happens. Otherwise, we have a yo-yo effect, how we say in Germany. I don't know whether you say this in other countries too. And usually, we do not have a realistic judgment on the conditions in the home system. How mature is the system? Are they used to learn something new? Or do they always have big plans and do nothing about it and have, again, big plans and not doing anything? So what is the maturity level? Is the system a learning system? Or is the system only a traditional and switching to enthusiastic and back switching to traditional system? So, and if you do not have a realistic judgment on that, the chance that you can bring an acceptable change to the system also is very little. And this has also to do with time, power, support, and so on. Very often, even if the bosses want the change, 3 weeks later they have a different idea what they also want. And say, withdraw support for the system and say, so it has to go its own way now. And this usually doesn't work. So I just want to mention typical learning events within system, within companies. This is workplace learning. We think a lot about when you are working together, let's say on a project, and you come to a point where you see there are things we have to learn new together unless we go on in our project. Do they have an idea to withdraw and say, let's take a small one, let's exercise our cooperation with that, and this is only on the under learning perspectives. We do not have to fulfill the task at this moment. So it's workplace learning embedded into the everyday organization of work. And in any creative professions, this is absolutely necessary. But it only works if everybody knows the rules and understands then the switch from the orientation from task fulfilling to learning, for example, or the roles within the learning process, or the setting, or who can direct it. The other thing is project learning. It's not, this is if it's not a everyday workplace, but something new, or if there's an organizational development. Very seldom learning space is defined within an OD project. Certainly they learn on their way anyways, no chance not to learn, but they do not have the awareness. This needs to be taken care purposely and have a didactic and can be combined with progress in the organizational development. So, one part is the actual learning process, as I mentioned already, to improve behavior. And the other thing is, do we develop a mutual shared culture of learning? So we always say, this is for the learning on the actual case. And at the same time, and we do this in our exercises, in our training group, now let's do a second part and analyze how we did that learning. Which roles did we have? Was it appropriate to what we wanted to learn? Did everybody clarify for him or herself when it's enough learned and all these things that they build up a learning culture together so that in the next case, the learning is more effective and it's easier to do that with each other. So it's all very often it's also implementing and developing a learning culture at the same time. And because no company can afford to hire a consultant or a teacher for every learning process, the whole didactic, the concepts, the tools should be usable for self-directed learning. These people should be able to use it themselves without becoming a psychologist. So this is why most of our concepts are no longer classical psychological concepts. Geethan will give you examples for that. Do you get a sense what I mean? How could it be different if we think in systems, integrated individual qualification and system qualifications at the same time? Some not, thank you. Okay. And I'm saying our usual educational programs are insufficient to create effective learning systems. And to better run a system together, a working system and a learning system, individuals should learn together. And this also has the consequences that we as specialists should not stay in our institutes and say, people come to us. We should go into the companies and see how they are learning anyway and how this can be improved from all these perspectives. And for this new and different mindset on working combined with learning, you need a lot of different settings, roles, processes, concepts and methods. And if you are interested in those we developed the last 30 years in Wiesloch, then visit our website. I don't know whether they give you the charts here. If you want, you can have the charts. But if you just go on Bernd Schmid and Google you certainly will find us. And you will find all our material free. And now I want to give you some examples of this kind of different perspectives. For example, how we understand professional competence. I only can go through this very quickly, but to give you a sense, this is role competence. Are you aware in which role you are acting now and want to learn. Because it's something different to learn, whether you learn collegial behavior or you learn leadership behavior. And are you aware of the roles your partner is in? And can you learn together? And we say it should always be leadership relationship training. These people who are in a leadership relationship should learn together, because then the chance that they still know it on Monday is much higher. And they complement each other in this learning process. And they find what's right for them, because it's different than for another relationship. So I always say the smallest unit of leadership is a leadership relationship. And in a company, it's even more, it's a leadership network and a leadership chain. Because what the CEO thinks should be done should go through the whole chain until the workplace and back. So it's a role competence. And people come to our training to learn roles. I want to be a leader or a consultant or a coach or whatever. But very often they do not understand the play. They do not understand the systems they are working in. They do not understand their professional field. They think, like musicians, if I exercise on my violin more and more and more, I will be great. No, they must understand how to address the market for violinists. And the success to be a violinist has a lot to do with understanding their situation and not with learning only playing the violin. And it's the equation is professional competence, is role competence times context competence. This means if role context is high but context competence is very low, the result is almost nothing. And then people often go back and learn more role competence. But this is not what's missing. It's missing they do not understand their system, the context. And the personality and the systems they are learning for should match somehow. And even if you understand the system, even if you know your roles, but it's not what you want to do in life, it's not fitting your personality and your values, then you will not achieve very much there, or at least not become very happy with that. So this is professional competence for individuals. But we have a second formula too, to understand how this goes with systems. System competent is the coordinated competent of single players. So a system is has learned as much, as better, the more many people together know how to play the new system. So the coordinated competence. It's not only that the boss learned new leadership behavior, it's also that his employees understand what he's trying to do and they learn their employee behavior that is complementary to the new leadership behavior. And then the system learning improves. And what I said before, system competence is as higher the more they have a shared learning culture. This has to do with maturity. If a company, for example, has built up a very good learning culture, let's say for introducing a new IT system, and they know how to learn and to deal with problems they have around, then they are mature also to learn together new elements, new cultural elements. And so the system competence is as higher as the more they have a shared learning culture. And sometimes we have the problem that systems who did not learn how to learn, they want the biggest change and they want to pay for it, but it's not cannot be done with money. And the whole thing has to be embedded. The learning system and the learning culture has to be embedded into the work culture, into the markets, into the behavior of partners. If they do try something different and usually they do it with other departments within the company or with other companies, and these do not react complementary to what they try to do, then it might fail. So if you want to know how competent is the system for change, then you have to activate all these perspectives and see how good are the resources. And if they are very low, then you only can, how we say in Germany, kleine Brötchen backen, bake small rolls. Also, they want to have big leaves. And that's a difficult part in the process, because they come to you when they need big leaves. And they do not want to hear that they are not able to bake more than small rolls if they invest a lot. So these are only some examples for new concepts we have. There's the notion of role. The interlocking, the interface between human individual and organization is organizational role. So we always work, we address people within their organizational roles or their professional roles when they do not learn for a specific organization but for a specific professional field, and not dealing with the whole personality, with the whole biography. Sometimes we need that, we need to refer to that. But we always have the question, how will this help to improve the organizational role? And sometimes the person could do fine, but the organization has very different ideas to do that. It's a mismatch. It's not a question of not knowing roles or not understanding context. It's just a mismatch. And then it doesn't help if they go to the third 2 years training. Then we help them to find a new company. It's easier. Not everything can be done by training. Okay. So this is on roles. We have written a lot of roles and said you must be aware in communication from which role do you communicate and which role in the other person do you activate by your communication. And for example, if your boss comes in and wants to tell you should do something this or that way, and he does it from his boss role and expects you to accept that he has the right to set priorities, but you answer from a professional collegial role, let's discuss that, this is state of the art in management, then you mismatch in communication because you are you do not handle the same role relationship system. And then it would be wonderful if you have a meta stance to observe that and talk about it. I'm not sure whether you are telling me just this is your decision or whether you want my opinion, whether I think this professionally is the most useful thing to do. And then you can clarify problems in communication. So we developed a lot of new communication models to deal with this kind of learning systems. And for example, we have a different definition of team. So team development, team coaching, team consulting. This is a big market. Much money is in that. But very often it means those who are on the same floor or are interested to do something together. Our definition of team is those who share responsibility. You defined what is the responsibility, what is the question we have to answer, responsibility. And if we have to answer this question as a system from different roles, but interplay of these roles, then we have to have a discussion on clarifying responsibilities. Who has to do what from which role? And certainly, the leadership relationship is part of that system. And so we have developed a lot of didactic material to define what is a reasonable team development work, and not just to do anything, something what you always do. On leadership, I said already something. Yeah, this would be too complicated. These are now strategic questions. How we can convince a company if they spend a lot of money and energy and resources on building up learning systems, how to organize it, how to implement this in their business strategy. Because if it's important learning, it must be somehow be really connected to the business strategy. Because always this is where the energy goes, because the money is there and the power is there. This is my last chart showing how we understand our institute, ISB Wiesloch. It's a learning island. And people coming, we do 2 years programs, 12 times 3 days. And average age of the professionals that come to us is about 40. And we have 2/3 of our participants are internals. And we have trained that way about 5,000 professionals in the last 20 years. So we have a big net, and many companies send their professionals over again to us. So many people who are trained on the same island, in the same learning culture, meet each other in the company. And so the chances that they together can transfer something to the company is increasing. And our whole didactic, our whole understanding how we train people on this island is oriented to how can they support learning systems when they are back home. So from this goal, we go back and say, and then what do we have to do in seminar learning to support this? And for example, this means we train them self-directed collegial learning and how they can introduce this to their colleagues when they are back home. This is much more important than a very in-depth personal analysis what their feelings at their workplace has to do with their biography. So it's a very much an educational approach oriented to systems and to society. And the older I grow, I'm now 70 and I'm retiring. This is one of the last four presentations I do, and then I stop. And our contribution really should be to help also to include the sociological aspects and really to contribute to change in society, because I've been a psychotherapist for 30 years. And I don't believe in society improvement by psychotherapy, not any longer. So, and this is so individual learning has its limits, and this might be a good point to pass over to you, Geethan. And for those who have heard the words and maybe somehow have been positively affected, but do not have an idea what does this mean Monday. Geethan will tell you what this means Monday. Oh, how can we change? Thank you.
Yeah. So, my name is Geethan. I come from India. And there is a connection between Heidelberg and my life is because I did my college and I learned BE, that is engineering in printing technology. And one of the key missionary supplier in printing business is Heidelberg. So we are not connected through the city, but through the company of Heidelberg. And there has been always a fantasy when I studied in college about Heidelberg, and and today, being here, meeting you all, and expressing my learnings over a period of time is a joy. So what do I mean by integrative approach to self and organizational development? I'm also a psychotherapist, as Bernd being a psychotherapist. And this orientation also gave me confidence that, yes, I can make a change in the organizations too. But then I later learned through my observation in what way it is effective and not effective. So I'm going to come with three questions today through which I will be explaining my understanding of organizational work. One is, how do I differentiate self-development work and organization development work? Another is, how to integrate self and organization development work? And other is, how do I use Dr. Bernd Schmid's model on organization development to develop organizational coaching in my context, in my country? So these are the areas I will be sharing the coming few minutes with you all. So how do I first differentiate it between the self-development and organizational development work? Let's say when I was a psychotherapist who was having psychology as a background, and when an organization tells me that they have a problem, that there are senior level managers and there are middle level managers, and the senior level managers may say, we tell the middle level managers that if you have any problem, please come back to us, but they don't seem to come. And then we come to know that there is a problem later, and it is surprising for us, and then there is a lot of conflict which happens. So earlier, if I hear this, then I will diagnose it, maybe meet few a middle-level manager, then I may feel, okay, they have low self-esteem. If they have good self-esteem, maybe they will come and talk to the managers. So what I may do is teach them on some amount of program where they could learn some self-esteem process. But when they go back to work, we really don't know whether they are able to sustain what they learned during the training program. As Bernd said, the old song may come again. So then, now what I do, if the same situation is shared, if the senior managers say, if my juniors are not telling if they have a problem, I may tell, okay, now let the leaders be here. I get your perspective. Let me also get some perspective from the middle level manager. And it's interesting, if you meet them, they say, we go over the problems, and they say, you have to solve it anyway. So why do we have to tell them the problem and get embarrassed that we have to solve it anyway? So then we also make a small change in the leader's competence, saying that instead of telling them, you tell if there is a problem, you ask, how did you solve the problem this week? Then you are introducing a different culture where people have started dialoguing on it. And then the leaders can always see whether they have solved the problem effectively. And if they want to add some input or mentoring, that is also a possibility. Now, since this is learned through the work, through the role competence between a leader and the subordinate, now what happens is when they work together, this is automatically translated to work. So that is how we can integrate the self-development and organization development together. Otherwise, if you're teaching them about self-esteem or how to solve problem, then it is more of a personality development program and not a self-development program. When I was sitting here and hearing to Bern, I had information which one of my professional colleagues was talking about. He was telling that once there was a CEO who told to a consultant that I am available in this floor, but no one comes and meets me. Then what the consultant did is he brought a big saw which can cut, you know, the woods, a big saw. And he cut the door of the CEO's cabin, and then he gave it like a cake to everyone, saying that now it's open. I was wondering, the CEO has the power to just go out and say, please come into my cabin. We need not do so much of work on bringing a saw, having a consultant for this. So these are more of a personality development orientation rather than integrating the self and organization development together, which I will tell you how I do in step-by-step process. I was also remembering a story where once there was a old lion and it is about to die in the forest, and the lion was the king, and someone else has to take over as the successor. So then they chose a monkey, which was very active, very aggressive, but very active. So they thought maybe this monkey has all the energy, so maybe we can have this monkey as a king. So once what happened, there was a sheep, and the sheep lost its calf, the baby sheep was lost. So it went to the monkey and said, "Monkey King, I lost my baby, can you help in finding it?" So the monkey started jumping from one branch to another, from another branch to another, another branch to another, another branch to another. The sheep asked, "What are you doing?" The monkey said, "I'm searching for your baby, and this is what I know how to do it. I am an expert in jumping from one tree to another, and I'm doing that effectively, hoping that I will get your baby." So many times when we bring expertise, like even me, when I was an expert, maybe in the form of some psychology orientation, I was like that monkey, hoping if I do these kind of workshops, some change will happen in the organization. So that is the time I met Bernd in 2012, and then I changed my perspective to orient myself to organization development. And so till now I have been talking about how do I differentiate the self-development and organizational development. Now I will move towards how do I integrate along with the perspectives of Bernd Schmid in organization development. I call this as B5 model. B stands for Bernd, and the five perspectives, which is important when I construct OD work. What are the five perspectives? Is if you see the common thread which we have is sharing. It's like a lifeline. In the palm, there is a lifeline for all of us. There are a lot of lines. Of that, sharing is a key area to keep in mind, one of the focus, because no change in an organization can be done if it is not shared. So there is a differentiation between an individual change, collective change, and a shared change. Because many times people think if there is a collective change, it will help the organization to grow. No. Collective change means you can bring, like for example, Bernd draw a team slide, a chart, where it had the vertical and the horizontal. So maybe a collective change is I gather few employees and conduct a training program to them. It's a collective change. But shared change is how do we take responsibility together to make some change? So sharing is most important thing than a collective process. Because something which we call it as in-betweenness, something is happening between us which we need to address, because organization is no more a personal experience, it's a social experience, because it's a social construct. So in-betweenness is more important, and how do we share the change process? The organization development itself is a shared organizational development process. It can never be done as collective process. It's a shared process. So what are the five perspectives we need to keep in mind? Is reality, shared responsibility, shared strategy, shared performance, and shared leadership. Now, one thing very interesting happens in organization is the leaders are more interested in which perspective in this? You may know. Where? Where do you think they're more interested in this five perspectives? Leadership. Performance. They immediately say, okay, your KPI, your KRA, KPI is key performance index, key performance area, dashboards, everything is on performance. We need performance. We need performance. Now, that is only one finger. So if you try to hold the organization energy using only one finger, then if you try this, it's very easy. It'll slip away. It's not, you cannot hold it just with one finger. So the more perspective is oriented towards performance, whereas the other three perspectives are sometimes not taken into account. What are the other three perspectives? One is how they shared reality between each other? How do they share responsibility between each other? How do they share strategy between each other? And how do they share performance between each other? And how do they share leadership between each other? These five perspectives, when they are taken into account, self-development and organization development happens together. I will tell you one example of how I use this maybe in three sittings in an agricultural equipment manufacturing company. So they have called me where there is a project which connects with a lot of departments. Many departments function together, but the project is going very slow. So the first day, I meet every department heads privately and maybe some of the subordinates in each department. Now, everyone seems to say that we are doing our best, but we don't get support from the other department. And every department is saying that. If every department is supporting each other, then this gap cannot be there. But that is where the shared reality is not there. Everyone thinks that they are giving their best, not taking effort to check whether the reality is shared or not. So once we did the first step, then we brought them together and talked about what happens again and again when they coordinate together. There were so many pain points where there were discomforts experienced by other departments which they came in touch with. Then the second step was discussion on, we went into responsibility, sharing responsibility. And it's very interesting, people started saying, if that department does, then I will do this. If that department does, then I will do this. So they were shifting the responsibility that they should make an initiative and then we will support. So that was the culture there. So then slowly we questioned, facilitated, and it's not confrontation, it is very empathetic because we need to understand their position for whatever they're doing. And then they came to the position of, okay, instead of saying, let the department do, then we will support, they started saying, I want to do this for you and how you can support me in this. So there was a change in perspective between them, which is a shared responsibility perspective where people are willing to offer responsibility and take responsibility. With this, the first setting was over. Usually, what we do, we always ask them to take a task and experiment through the task when they apply these learnings together. That is where it becomes directly beneficial for the organization. So they took the task of enhancing the graph of this project from 60% to 75%, 15%, how they can shorten the time, the quality, and how they can do it in a coordinated way. So the first sitting was over, and they were given a gap of 30 days. And the next 30 days, I go. I know there will be something done, and maybe still a little more to be addressed. So in the second sitting, we gave the question, three questions. What they were able to do together, what they initiated, but they couldn't sustain. They thought of initiating something, but they couldn't. It was an interesting discussion between them. Now, how do I frame this question is because I know now they have come to the level of sharing reality and responsibility. But for them to have a strategy to make a change, they may require a leadership support, which we have not yet addressed. We have only addressed interdepartmental, but the operation heads have not yet been brought together. But in the second sitting, we have already invited the operation head to be a part of the learning process. So when they hear to the situation of where the leaders are struggling or where the team members are struggling, then the operation VP was able to give a little more freedom, power, resources. And now what happens is sharing of responsibility happens not only in the horizontal level, but between the horizontal and the vertical level also. This leads to shared performance and shared leadership. And this was done in just 2 days of work. And the third day I go, they have done a lot of presentations, and this time not only one vice president, we have invited four vice presidents to be a part of the learning process. And like this, if we continue for maybe 6 or 7 sittings in over a period of 3 to 4 months, we see a very new culture in the organization that people get a lot of benefit, a satisfaction that they're able to contribute, and the organization feels that there is a development as an ongoing process aligned with OD. So that's the reason I call it as an integrative approach of self-development and organization development. So now we will do one small exercise through our own hand. It's like, now instead of just holding the organization reality through performance, if the leader is able to bring reality together, first, he understands the reality of people. Then he understands how the responsibility is shared between them, helps them to form good strategy, and be a part of their performance. Now if you see, the organization energy is held together like this. Then it's not easy, he doesn't slip away. So that's the reason, if you see one of the slides of Bernd, it was saying that address the cultural problem first, then go to the result orientation. So if we are able to have a culture where all these perspectives can be brought together, the internal strength of the organization can be made very much healthier. And what is OD is to build an internal strength for an organization, because external market is fluctuating and we as consultants are not expert in the industry expertise. But what we can do is people in the industry already know what they know. We just have to bring them together so they have a good internal strength. And that internal strength is bringing these four perspectives. It's not moving, let's see. So how do I integrate the organization development work and the self-development process is always start learning as an initiative through the work rather than away from work. So I call it as a parallel approach to training and integrative approach to training. What do we mean by parallel approach to training is teaching is done in one place and then expected to transfer in the work context. Rather, the integrative approach is take the work context and learn through that. Like how we did in the agriculture company, equipment manufacturing company. Yeah, thank you. I told about parallel approach. Now we are talking about the integrative approach. And then we also learn through role competence. Now what do we mean by role competence is, let's say I get an example where the organization says my people are not taking quick decisions. They have decision making problems. Now this can be addressed as a personality problem, but because people are very adaptive or people are anxious to take decision, it can be seen from a personality development program or a self-development program also. But we can see this as a role competence. So then role is always a shared identity. It is never a single identity, because if a person has to be a mother or a father, they have to have a child. Otherwise, this role does not exist. It's a shared identity. So if there is a manager, then he has a subordinate. If there is a leader, there is a follower. So already a role is a shared identity. It is never a single identity. So the role competence is how people in this role can come together to perform in a competent way and how they learn that. Like for example, this decision making, what we invited to do is we invited the senior managers and the subordinates, and the senior managers asked a question: what do they think about the decisions they can take on their own? So that list was made. And where they think they need the support of the manager. And once this dialogue was done, they started experimenting for themselves that how they can make such quick decisions. And whenever they have doubt, how they can access the leader to clarify on the decision-making process. Now, this is change through role competence. Not necessary to access the self of the person at all. So what do I now understand is personality is a huge area which has conscious, unconscious, childhood, so many things. So we need not access a personality side and hope that this will impact the role. Rather, through the role, you accept the sufficient amount of personality. That is sufficient. And Bernd also said, your essence of personality is exhibited through your roles you play in your life. The essence of your personality is exhibited through the roles you play in your life. So if we can play the roles effectively, it also impacts the personality. But hoping that we will impact the personality and then coming back to the roles, it doesn't fit the organizational context. So this is what I was talking about, building an internal strength for the organization, which happens when we learn through work and developing change through role competence. Now what happens is, what do we mean by learning culture here? Is when I started learning from Bernd, it was one point where I came to an understanding, it is very difficult to change a culture, or sometimes maybe not possible also. But what we can do is introduce healthy culture. And by introducing new culture, you can address the old culture also. Like for example, a practical example is, I work with the dairy industry for a long time in doing this interdepartmental coordination for them. Milk industry. They are one of the biggest industry, private industry in India, whom I work for. We have been doing for last 4 years. I will also tell how it impacts the culture is, if you take the milk and you apply some amount of yogurt, which is like a culture, and then it converts itself into yogurt. And then you take some of that and put in another container of milk, that also gets converted to a kind of a yogurt. So if you, culture breeds culture. So that's what Bernd used to tell, it's culture breeds culture. So you just have to introduce good culture and that will anyway breed. And the practical example I saw is in 2013, I introduced this kind of a learning culture through work and role competence in only one factory. They got the benefit so much. For the last three years, we have expanded our work into all the 14 factories they have. And also their procurement and marketing department, which has more than 600 employees in each department. So over a strength of 10,000 employees, it's a huge organization. But just working with few leaders and the key people who can influence the organization, building a learning culture where they can learn through their role competence and work, we have been able to make a good impact. And what do I mean by culture breeds culture is, in one factory we introduced, it breeded to 14, 15 factories. Which means it helps the whole organization to want to have such kind of a culture. And
how do you multiply? How does this multiplying happen?
How does it multiply?
Yeah.
When we do in one factory, then what do we do is, that was an interesting part. Is first we thought by just taking one culture and spreading in other factories it will work. But the human system was so complex that we have to develop new culture for every factory. So it took a challenge. Now how do we do that is, let's say there is each factory as managers, and these factories are connected with vice presidents. So at least one vice president is part of one factory when we create a learning space. So what happens is when these people are able to see that there is a change, so these leaders invite the same culture into another factory also. So then it keeps spreading from one factory to another. Another thing we do is when one factory does their success story, now that is presented to other plant factory managers also. So then they see it is possible to do something different and they invite us. And earlier we started with the dairy milk division, and then this spread into the ice cream division where my colleague, she is doing the same work. She's here, Anuradha, she's here. So she does for the ice cream company, which is the same management. So it's like Once you introduce people feeling comfortable to learn through their work, they get the result, and then since the senior leaders are part of it, they're able to see, yes, this needs to be transferred, and they have the power to do that kind of a transfer, and then this is culture from one factory is spread to another. That's how it's been happening. Okay, I think I have shared what I have to share, and maybe one thing with which I would like to close is, if you see this, Bernd, do you think I have answered the question of how this transfer has happened?
Yes. What is still unclear is it cannot only be done by power from the vice president. Who is carrying the learning culture to the other factory?
That's a good question. And this is one of the culture is to clarify, which we introduced in the other organization also. Like Bernd had a question, and whether I assume that I have to talk more, rather clarify it. Yes, in this organization, power plays a vital role. But when we are sitting in the learning situation, there is no power involved. The vice president steps away from the role of a vice president, and they sit as a learning colleagues together. And in that process, they learn about their own work, how they do together, what they can do differently. And then that also creates a kind of bonding between them, where they can trust each other, and that trust also influences the other factory. But why it is important that we have a power as a part of it is, like for example, there are systems which is formed in the organization, even though a person wants to change their behavior, without the support of leaders, they are not able to make a change. It's because the system doesn't permit a change. So since the leaders are part of it, they can also define how they can work together within the scope of the organizational system so that there is no change which is affecting the organization brand or the product. So in that way, it gives a safety to have the senior people as a part of it. Yeah.
How did you choose the first company you went to? I assume that must be a company with a lot of credibility for all the other 40 ones, so that they don't say, it might work for them and not for us. You know what I mean? That they say, yeah, you can do it in that part, but we are so different, that won't work. So, how do you choose the first company you
want to? So, you're asking within the company or different companies?
No. You said that there were 40 different
departments.
Departments.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
How do you choose the first one? Was this the head or just
okay.
Part of the company with a lot of credibility for all the other parts?
Credibility for all the parts and the head. So what we do is we never take one perspective. That is where the shared reality is, that we need to take multiple perspectives. So we don't go with one perspective. So it's many perspectives. But it's interesting is when we see many perspectives, we can always see whether there is enough sharing of reality or not. And when you bring them together, then it becomes to their visibility that how the reality is matching or not matching. It was interesting in one organization, the senior managers told, we have a very good relationship between our subordinates and there is no difference between us. When I met the subordinates, they had a huge list where the leaders don't understand their requirements at all. And it was surprising when they both sat together and spoke and the leaders said, why don't you tell all these things that we have this problem? And they said, you never ask for it. It's an interesting thing, like you go and leave your car for the service. When you go with your family, we don't talk about, I hear some noise or there is a small wobbling. But when you go to the service, you say these things are there. So sometimes when the consultant is available, they have a little more space to talk about what is aligned, what is not aligned, and all those things. But for that to happen, for them to happen, one step, maybe Bernd was right in asking the question is, we prepare them for that. How do we prepare them is, one of the thing perspectives we can also take is Edshine, is one of the consultant in culture. So he talks about three levels of relationship, which is L minus one, L1, L2, and L3. L minus one is treating people like slaves, you know. You just extract what you want and then leave them. This is L minus. L1 is, yeah, I'm your manager and you're my subordinate. For the courtesy, we work together. L2 is they're trusting to share their problem with the other person. And knowing that this person will not mislead me. This is L2. And L3 is becoming too intimate. So in an organization, we should not aim at L3. Because if we become too close, then maybe the objectivity is also lost. So L2 is trust and not misleading each other. That much I know, this person will not mislead me. So as a consultant, my first work will be to build that L2 relationship. In, like when you ask each department, I may have to spend maybe half an hour to each head to understand their issues, what they go through internally, what they go through in the situation, the organizational culture, and empathize with them in different levels so they are able to get into the L2 relationship. And that L2 relationship forms the base for the culture to transfer from one factory to another, from one department to another, where there is actually no power, but there is already a trust between the consultant and the employees. And if we have not achieved the L2, we don't start our work. We take time. But usually, if we are prepared for the L2, it happens instantaneously. That's what is my understanding. It just happens even in 20 minutes. Because I have done that within a day for more than 10 departments together, or even 14 departments together, privately, and then bringing them together. Okay. Yeah, I think so.
Can this L2, what does it mean?
What are the evidences? They are able to share their problems openly with the consultant. If they are able to say, I have this problem and this is what I'm going through because of this, then they have come to L2. If they have not come to L2, they will say, I want this change, and they will not actually say that they have a problem. That is one of the evidence, if the person has come to L2 or not.
And what we do is we create fishbowl situations. If they are not used to communicate in that way very effectively, we invite somebody who is ready to be interviewed. And then Geethan or another consultant interviews this person in a way the others would not be, would not do effectively. What are you trying to do? What are the points where you feel you are stuck? Or whom do you need on the stage to perform better? Do you have a relevant relationship with this person? What have been your further experiences that give you ideas what could work and what could not work? When will you be satisfied? What would you give in turn? Many reasonable questions that shows a map for acting in a shared reality of this person out of her role and responsibility. And we do not allow then discussions at that point. Then we might, then after having said the interview, ask the other people, how did you experience this interview? And they say, oh, now I know things I never knew. And then we could think about creating a cooperation situation. Okay, you can choose two or three people in this round you need for your performance. Tell them what you try to do with them and how you think about they should cooperate, that you together can help to fulfill your responsibility. And then ask them whether they are willing to do so. And if they have a different view on that, then they discuss about maybe they have a different understanding of responsibility. So something is missing, or an old understanding of responsibility is no longer valid because the world has changed. And it's dialogue. It's sharing, 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 sharing. And if they are not mature to do this for themselves, then we show them how to do so. And it's interesting that people who seemed that they cannot do it, they are infected by this culture. And when they switch into that role, they are much more competent than we thought they are, or that they thought they are, because culture brings in the front of personalities the best of everybody if the culture is inviting something good.
Maybe we both will jointly answer some questions. And one perspective which I thought I will add with what Bernd was talking about is, though sometimes the senior leaders see the benefit of it, and they may ask the new situation that we would like to have something like this, it may be a power position where they say, I think we need to get into this kind of a work. Sometimes the subordinate agree. But one of the perspective of Bernd in developing responsibility is people are obligated to do in an organization because they are paid for it. We are all obligated, even as a consultant. But how do I move this from have to situation to want to situation? So we sometimes invite them to say, yes, now your senior leaders want this from you, and you are willing to do because you have to do. What we can do in such a way that you will say that I want to do rather than we have to do it. So then it becomes a different perspective on their own motivation level. And then we frame questions in fishbowl like, okay, what part of them helps them to feel that they want to, and what part of them says that I have to?
And these are two dimensions of a four-dimensional concepts we introduce. And so are you supported to do so if you want it? And are you trained to do so? Because sometimes people do as if they could do it and are not allowed, and they are not clear about they are not competent enough. They are not. They do not meet the reality that they just do not have ideas, for example. In leading teams, one of the myths of leading teams is we would have creative ideas if we would be allowed to do. But it's not true. Very often they have discussed a lot what are the obstacles against their creativity, and not admitting that they are not creative. That's the truth. And we not only invite dialogue situations, like you said, we also give them some very simple instruments. Either do I have to answer this question? Am I entitled to answer these questions? Do I have the resources from the organization to answer these questions? Do I want to answer this question? Is it according to my values? And am I qualified to do so? And we have a sheet, a working sheet paper, so that while they are dialoguing with each other, they look at these 4 points. And then they think about, is it really a question of not being allowed, or is it to be true a question of not be able to? Or they give each other feedback on, you say, you act as if you are forbidden to be creative, but I do not see that you have ideas. So let's talk about this. There's a different limitation to take over responsibility. And if you have the role, for example, to be creative, and we all depend on your creativity, and you do not admit that you do not have any ideas so that we can find different solutions, then we are altogether stuck. And then there's a dialogue on that.
I think she has a question.
For me, it's one very important thing is that they're really talking to each other and trying to understand the position of the other person. So I'm asking myself, how did you do that? That they are really willing to listen, to understand the position of the other person instead of just trying to explain their own position again and again and again. And what is your experience about which kind of questions help, which kind of interventions help?
As we already said, it's a lot of modeling. Either we invite them to dialogue going along steps in a sheet, we give them a didactic, or we give them a model by making a fishbowl and interviewing somebody. And this person finds out, if there are clever questions, it's nothing to hide. Everybody has a benefit of clarification, and then the attitude of the others changes.
I would add to this idea, because most of the situation is even very difficult to make them talk before their own seniors or among their own peers. First, I thought it is a culture problem in my own company, but even in other country, I see that there are sometimes there is difference between departments or different layers. So one thing what I understood is, if you ask them to tell about their problems or what they go through, no one talks about it. But what we do is, particularly in understanding with Bernd, is we don't ask about the issues. We ask about what are the events which is happening in the organization which they would like to change. So it is not on them. It's about something which is happening. Like, for example, they say, we wait for this decision for a long time. And sometimes if we don't get this from this department, so we have to do this more here. So they are only talking about the events, not about this person is not doing, that person is not doing, no. So that makes them feel safe. They are talking about something which is happening in the organization. But there is also a perspective happening to every individual, seeing that, oh, maybe I could have done something there. So naturally, when we ask them, okay, now what you're doing, they automatically say at that time, okay, I think we will do something different so that this can be avoided. That's how the thing happens, where people are open. And as he said, the fishbowl can be created based on each perspective. Like, for example, if we sense reality is a mismatch, then we may ask this question about, okay, where do you see the events are happening which is not in accordance to your expectation? But if I see responsibility is an issue, then the questions which can be very different from the frame, it could be one question I framed, I remember, is where you are very much satisfied with your role, where you think that you are overworking, and where you think in your own roles, yeah, I am very confident in these areas, but in some of my role, it's still gray. When they spoke about it, they were able to see that they are taking some additional responsibility because someone else is not taking responsibility. But this is not spoken to them, taught to them, saying that everyone has to take responsibility. These questions open a dialogue, and it brings to the visibility of what is happening there, and people accordingly adjust. So that's how, when he said, have a model, frame questions, and bring it to the surface for discussion or dialoguing.
And in one way, it's nothing new. Every good corporation is like this. But we make a program out of it, a cultural program. And we develop instruments and a didactic and a role understanding and saying this is professional to do so. Or to be a regisseur of learning processes is part of leadership. So we help to make it programmatic. What is happening spontaneously, certainly all over the world. And as you see, the more we talk about learning together, close to our task, in the frame of our everyday work, together with the people we usually have to share responsibility, the more you do not have psychological ideas. They fade. They still have this perspective. I've been psychotherapist for many, many, many years. It's still sometimes important, and it's not working without that. But what we as professionals, most of us come from psychotherapeutic orientation. We have so many cultural habits and hopes that this will work somehow, that we really have to change our programmatics on that.
I sometimes working with teacher colleagues, and two things I think can be a little bit problematic. One thing is that you come to two points when you speak, not, well, perhaps not about problems, but points that you have to work with. You come to a point where you're a little bit afraid that you lose your face. And when you come to a point that you say it's something you have to work on. And also I can imagine, or this experience, that motivation to show these points where you have these special problems in this sphere with colleagues that you meet the next Monday is also restricted. Yeah. Motivation is not too high to show this weak points of your competence. So what? How do you deal with that?
I think sometimes it's difficult to come over that. Yeah. But it might, to look at this in this way, may also be a consequence of our pathological view as professionals. We usually look for those people who have the most problems, and we want to do something for them, and that's the most difficult to do. If you use the perspective of cultural work, you invite these people and say, you don't have to be engaged here. It's just okay, you sit here and watch, and then I ask you, what happens to the other people? How do you find that? And give them roles, for example, invite them to interview others and see if they can be effective and empathetic with it. And after some time, they change their way of being in this culture, and then they slowly start also to talk about their personal problems.
Yeah.
But we do not start with that.
Yeah.
In psychotherapy, when I learned, this is a trap track. The track towards directly going to the problems is a trap.
Hmm. Yeah, in my understanding also, sometimes people may feel embarrassed to talk about their own self issues. But we need to build a culture for managers to show their vulnerability. But it happens over a period of time. And usually they are willing to do when they know that they will be supported through the vulnerability and not seen as that it's weakness. So that happens when they work together. Because somehow it's not only my contribution for my vulnerability, it is also someone else not doing something or not being clear adds to this. So when they share their perspectives on it, it's much more easier to handle the vulnerability. One example which came to my mind is one of the subordinate told me that he is reporting to a senior maintenance in charge, and he is very anxious that whenever he asks for a report and asks for a few more questions, then he becomes too anxious and he's not even able to answer. He becomes blank. Now, if you see, it's a vulnerable situation for a manager to tell this to his own boss, that, you know, I become anxious and all those things. And we also need not encourage them into that kind of a situation. What we did is, when the senior manager and the junior sit together and when they talk, now, one agreement we formulated is, instead of the senior person asking for the report and asking questions, how it will be if the junior takes two times in a week and report on his own to the senior manager. So we just changed the driver seat position. Instead of he asking, this person taking an initiative to share. Now, when the junior is doing, he is much more calmer state of mind because it is not something coming from there, but it is coming from his initiative. And the leader supports it, saying that, yes, for 2 days, I allot you this time, and you can report to me. Now, once he has done this for 2-3 weeks, then automatically this vulnerability is addressed, even without getting into addressing this vulnerability. So that is where we differentiate between the self-development work and the role competence. Here, we are making the leader and the subordinate to play their role competently, and thereby addressing the personal issue. And not through addressing the personal issue and expecting that to make a change in the role. So this is a differentiation between the self-development work and the organization development work. And integrating self-development and organization development. So it's a differentiation and integration.
And it's 5:30 now,
I think,
our end point. And this sentence seems to be appropriate to end our session to me. Yeah, thank you for listening so much and being interested in asking and discussing with us. Thank you.